Hi, and welcome to our first EDCOM webinar session, consisting of a 20-minute presentation, followed by a 10-minute session for your questions. You can participate in the Q&A session when you open the Q&A panel on the right-hand side, type your question in the text box, and then click Send. Micky Denehy, a leading advertising expert with over 30 years of international experience in the industry, is our presenter today and will introduce you to the subject, Building Emotional Connections Between Brands and Consumers to Create a Loyalty by Beyond Reason. Enjoy and have fun.
Hi, I'm going to talk about building emotional connections. My background, as Tamara said, is 30 years in advertising, 8 years in the UK working for Ogilvy, and then a creative agency, GGT, Gold, Green, Leaf, Trot, before I was approached by a headhunter to go and run a very large domestic Turkish advertising agency in Istanbul called Güzel Sanatlar, which I did and thoroughly enjoyed the experience. We joined the Bates Worldwide Network, and for 5 years we built the business. After that, I worked with Bates as the European New Business Director for 2 years. Then I went to Dubai to run the Dubai office and the Middle East region before returning to the UK, where I took an international role with Saatchi & Saatchi across Europe, Middle East, and Africa. So lots of interesting times and lots of stories to tell. My current role is as the principal of the EACA School of Advertising, and we run training courses for people across Europe, as well as running training courses and summer schools for students. So let's kick off on this thinking. A lot of the thinking you'll hear is from Saatchi & Saatchi's Love Marks thinking. It starts with the first home truth, which is that there aren't any bad products left. The truth is that consumers are too demanding, and if manufacturers try and put poor products on the shelf, consumers will simply reject them. And that's coupled with the second home truth, which is the leader's performance edge has never been smaller. So despite the fact I spent many years at Bates looking at the USP and trying to find product differentials, today the ability to copy very quickly any performance edge has really disappeared. So brand owners are now looking to having to build connections beyond just a USP and start building emotional connections, which is what we'll talk about. And it was based on this that Kevin Roberts, the worldwide CEO of Saatchi & Saatchi, came up with the thinking of love marks. And that is, in his words, described as a product, a service, or an entity that inspires loyalty beyond reason. And it is this loyalty beyond reason that every single brand owner, every marketing director, and indeed every agency CEO is desperate to achieve. Because what we want are consumers who really are loyal to our brands. And we know from many years in marketing that it is the heavy, loyal users of brands that produce the real big revenue and profit for brands. So creating that loyalty has become critical in the modern marketing era. So to give some idea of what Saatchi and Kevin meant by love marks, take the Harley-Davidson and the Suzuki. Clearly, in terms of performance, or if you like, the performance edge, that Suzuki has it. It is faster 0 to 60 or 0 to 100. It uses less fuel. It has cheaper spare parts. But the truth is that for people, once they buy a Harley, the smell, the sound, and the sheer enjoyment of the Harley-Davidson makes it a love mark for them. It's very unlikely that Harley-Davidson's rider will ever switch across, whereas for the Suzuki driver or rider, he may well choose several brands over the course of his biking career. And even more so in the world of software and hardware, compare the Apple with almost any other manufacturer. I'm speaking to you here from an HP laptop. I have no connection with my laptop. But for those of us who enjoy Apple and the iPods and the iPads, Apple have built up a really close relationship between brand and consumer. And therefore, once people have gone into Apple, it's very rare that they switch out. Whereas for me, I may well replace my HP with the Samsung or with a Toshiba. I don't have that loyalty. So when Kevin came up with the concept of love marks, he took a very simple axis, which is the respect axis versus the love axis. And if you look in the bottom left-hand corner, this is where we find everyday products, be they train operators, telephone companies, bread or milk manufacturers. They are merely products. If we go to the bottom right, which is where we have products that are not respected, but perhaps loved for a while, we're looking at the world of fads. And here we look at the likes of many of the games, like Tamagotchi, or pop groups like the Spice Girls, who have very high love, very high affection for a short while, but really no respect for the actual performance or delivery. It's certainly possible to make money out of there, but it's not a place where you're going to make a long-term successful brand. If you go top left, where we have many, many of the brands that I've certainly dealt with and the world of advertising deals with, these are brands that are highly respected, but perhaps just haven't built that emotional connection. And the danger with this territory is that over time, you can become somewhat bland and boring. So clearly, looking at this axis, the place we believe that people should aspire to is the top right-hand sector. Absolutely critical that you must have the respect, the performance must be there, and that coupled with a love is what pushes you towards the love mark territory. And this thinking is supported very much by neuroscience, and I'm sure many of you have looked into this in your universities. But if you look at the wiring of the brain, it favors the emotion. The connections from the emotional systems to the rational cognitive systems are stronger than the connections that run the other way. Or perhaps put more eloquently by a professor of neurology in British Columbia, the essential difference between emotion and reason is that emotion leads to action while reason leads to conclusions. And the last thing that any brand owner wants is the consumer rationally concluding that A is a better brand than B, but in fact they end up buying brand B simply because they have an emotional attachment. And what's very interesting in looking at this emotional area, I mean, take for example my story. I went to Istanbul on what would appear a completely irrational basis. I was going to give up a good job in the UK, go and work in a country that was a Muslim country while I'm a Christian, in a country I didn't speak the language, I didn't understand the culture, and rationally, I shouldn't have taken the job. But emotionally, having spent some time in Istanbul exploring the agency in the city, I simply fell in love with Istanbul. I thought it was the most interesting and exciting city. And my reason to take the job was based purely on an emotional decision-making process. And likewise, a friend of mine is a real estate vendor. He sells apartments and houses. And he gave me an extraordinary fact, which is the average time it takes for someone to decide whether or not they want to buy a property is 30 seconds. And what happens is they walk around several properties and they find one they just like the feel of, and emotionally the decision is made to buy it. Of course, there's lots of then rational backtracking to say, well, of course, I can turn the second room into a useful study or the commute to work is not too bad. But the decision has been made on an emotional basis. So when looking at the journey to a love mark, if you like, it's a very straightforward journey from being unknown as a brand when you perhaps go launch a new brand. Then obviously with some successful advertising, you become known. And then hopefully known for something or even known for good things. And as you move up towards the love mark territory, you should begin to feel that you're being known for things that are different. A bit like when you meet someone for the first time, as you get to know them, what makes them very interesting and perhaps more involving are when you begin to get to know them better and know the things that are different about them, things that will surprise you about them. And indeed, as you move on towards becoming a love mark in terms of a brand, if you can become known for things that I really care about, where there's a real emotional connection, then you're beginning to get into the area of love marks. And quite often we describe this as owning an emotional territory. And that's something that we think is a really powerful area for driving loyalty beyond reason. Now, many brands get stuck in what we might call a differentiation trap, where they become known for good things, and then through research and development, they invest in getting a performance edge, and they then become known for things that are different. But as I said earlier, the competition catches up, they have to reinvest in research and development, again, to become known for things that are different. It's a very expensive way to buy loyalty from your consumers. And in Kevin's word, it's the newer, the brighter, the stronger, the bolder, the cheaper. Many washing powders traditionally washed whiter than white, or cars drove faster or more economically. It's all the ER words, expensive way of doing it. So certainly our belief is that the way out of that trap is to move from known for things that are different into things that are much more emotionally based, known for things that I care about. And what we believe is that it's moving from what you might call a transactional relationship between brands and consumers to much more of a relationship. And when you think about relationships between brands and consumers, I'm not talking about customer relationship marketing. I'm talking about real relationships as there would be between people or within a family, whether it's a fling or a secret affair, whether it's marriage, or whether you're just trying out a new relationship. And brand owners must really look at the relationships with consumers much more as they would between people rather than simply as transactions. And I want to play you a commercial here. I'm going to click out into the file to try and get better quality. I said earlier that telecommunications were in the bad bottom left quadrant. In Saatchi New Zealand worked with a telecom down there and produced this commercial.
It's not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. I was once like you are now, and I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. I think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not.
Now, I know there's been quality issues. I hope you're able to see the commercial with that fantastic cast. Stephen's father and son soundtrack. As I said earlier, for many telecom operators, they are simply products. But in New Zealand, with emotionally triggered advertising like this, New Zealand Telecom have become a love mark. And certainly, I've seen that commercial many times, but whenever I view it, as both a father and a son, I have absolute desire to pick up the phone and just call my dad or call my son, because I think it's one of those emotional triggers that works brilliantly. In looking at what are the drivers behind creating love marks, we did a lot of research with QualiQuant, a very big research company, and they said there were three real drivers, which were mystery, sensuality, and intimacy. In terms of mystery, what they were saying is that people were really interested in brands that had stories, where brands that didn't give you everything up front, where there was still something to find out about brands. And in the UK, we have a product called Mr. Kipling, and those of you in the UK will know that. We never meet Mr. Kipling, but we have in our minds a thought of what he may look like. And here's an example.
Mr. Kipling's just around Scruffy.
I know, dear. But he does make exceedingly good cakes.
Kipling is one of those mysterious figures who we never meet. And by referring to him but never showing him, they've built up a huge brand in terms of the manufacture of cakes and biscuits. The second driver is sensuality. And by this, I mean using the full range of the senses, the smell, the sight, the sound, the taste, because it's through the use of the senses that we can really build up very strong connections with brands. And to give you one quick example, The British Airways, in the heyday before Virgin Atlantic took a big chunk of their business, used really one soundtrack, and that immediately captures the height of British Airways, which was the world's favourite airline. And just a few bars of that soundtrack very quickly conjure up a huge number of emotions and images and thoughts and feelings about British Airways, which works extremely well. I'm going to skip the next ad, which was an ad for Ariel, and move on to the third driver, which is intimacy. And this is really a point that some brands are extremely good using social media, using very involving communications and conversations, becoming very close to the consumers, or at least the consumers feel that they are close to the brand. And globally, one of Saatchi & Saatchi's biggest clients is Procter & Gamble. And using a really intimate understanding of mothers, or mothers-to-be as well, the Pampers brand has become a multi-billion dollar brand because it really understands what mothers worry about, which is, are they doing the best for their baby? And here's a great example of an ad from New Zealand, from Argentina. The challenge at the end of that commercial was, are you doing the right thing for your baby's development? Really understanding the emotional, the intimacy between Pampers and the mothers. And Pampers.com has become one of the biggest online call points for young mothers who've got concerns about what they should be doing to help their child's development. So those are the three drivers. What I want to very quickly, just to finish the webinar, is look at, if you like, 10 tips or 10 suggestions about how brand owners can get towards becoming a love mark in the eyes and the hearts of their consumers. The first is to really appreciate that love marks are built around consumer understanding. You absolutely need to understand consumers' desires and what they want in terms of the brand's delivery. And here is a great example, and there's a wonderful ad that was done to really show how girlfriends sometimes use it.
Okay, Mike, I know you think your truck is totally sick, but this is what I think of your precious 4x4 hang out all day with your stupid friend's truck! Push it! No! No!
So a really great insight into understanding how girlfriends view the friend's truck. The second tip is about love marks really tend to build up their consumer communication based on one word, equity. So a love mark is able to capture its emotional essence in a single word. And perhaps the best example from the world of Toyota, which worldwide handles is handled by Saatchi & Saatchi, is the whole concept of pride, pride of ownership. And it's through this idea that consumers are incredibly proud of driving Toyota that the brand has become the biggest car manufacturer in the world. And around brands, products like the Prius and some of the other more upmarket Toyotas, there's a real sense of pride of ownership that's developed behind it. The third key area is getting consumers' attention. And a love mark is able to surge through the clutter with ideas and emotions and experiences that really surprise and interest people. And there's a great example from Denmark for a travel company called Kilroy, and one of my favorite Danish commercials.
Yeah, it's good to go. We're rolling. You got that on the radar? Oh my God! Can't see the size of that. It's gonna hit! Oh, that was close.
Advertising like that at Kilroy in Denmark, and I wonder if there are any Danish listeners to ask this morning, but they've really built a love mark out of that brand. I'm going to skip the next commercial, which is one from Argentina, and move on to the fourth tip, which is emotional connections. And this comes back to some of the stories I was telling earlier, but a love mark acts on the fact that human beings make their decisions emotionally. And Monster.com are Europe's biggest online recruitment engine, and they help people find jobs, but they do it by really understanding how people feel and some of the fears they have when thinking about a job or thinking of moving from a job, and this is a great example of that.
It's the boss. So what are you going to do? Let him score? What sort of man are you? Stand up to him. He'll respect you, Buck. But then, he is the boss. You'll make him look stupid. He'll hold it against you. You can kiss that promotion goodbye. What the? Hey, isn't that the new kid from finance?
That's what you should have done!
It was a test! But wait, there's still time.
For career advice worth listening to and thousands of jobs, visit monster.co.uk.
So Monster have really built up their brand on really understanding the consumer in its purest sense there. I think the other thing is brands increasingly are becoming global players is the ability to have local connections. And Lovemark keeps its relationships alive with insights from the local. So even global brands must absolutely find a way of connecting locally. And to take another Procter & Gamble example, here's Head & Shoulders advertising on billboards in Poland. And clearly Poland and Warsaw in the winter gets very cold, but a very simple headline that says it can't fall here, coupled with underground heaters to make sure that the snow melts underneath the billboard, is a very nice way of demonstrating the efficiency with which Head & Shoulders keeps dandruff at bay. And likewise in Poland, where roads are a real problem in the winter with a lot of damage from frost and snow, by ensuring that the pedestrian crossings were repainted every 3 days, Lendermed, who are a teeth whitening, white strip, were able to ensure that no matter how bad the weather, the Warsaw pedestrian crossings remained bright and shiny, which is a great product demonstration coupled with local understanding. And I think the other critical thing is that it's not clients or it's not agencies that determine when a customer or when a client, when a product becomes a love mark, is when the customer says so. Because customers are ultimately the people who determine when a love mark becomes a love mark. And take, example, the story of the Coca-Cola Classic. When Coca-Cola decided to stop manufacturing the classic formula Coca-Cola, there was a huge uprising in America. And one old lady sent a really vitriolic letter of complaint, and she said, I have only three things in my life, God, my country, and my Coke, and now you've taken one of them away from me. Not surprisingly, Coca-Cola very quickly went back to start offering the classic recipe Coca-Cola, because it's true that consumers own the love-mark relationship. And the seventh thing is distinctivity. Love-marks have to be distinctive and easily recognized. Now, many of you may begin to recognize what this brand logo is. It is, of course, Guinness, one of the most distinctive and quickly and easily recognized of the beer brands, despite it being not for everybody. For people who enjoy and love Guinness, it is the fact that it is so distinctive that helps establish it as a love mark. Point eight is a love mark connects the company with its people and its brands. It's absolutely critical that the promise that a love mark makes is supported by the way people experience the brand, whether it's in store, at a point of service, or in the point of after sales. absolutely there has to be an innate connection between what the brand promise is and the people who deliver that brand. And going back to pride, before Toyota and Saatchi & Saatchi developed the concept of pride of ownership, it was clear that every single one of the sales people across the world of Toyota and the showrooms needed to back up the sense of pride of ownership. And I think the ninth point here is that it's not just about advertising at all. Love marks need to design compelling and sensual experiences at every point it touches the people. So from the in-store marketing, through the social media contact, through the experience of the brand, and of course the advertising, it needs to be a total experience, a consistent experience across. And I want to play as a last commercial an ad for Lexus, which captures the feeling that driving a Lexus gives beautifully. Brand owners who want to develop love marks is to nurture the future, because it's not a short-term thing. This is a long-term relationship that needs attention, and brands that appreciate that and consistently go back and create those long-term relationships are more likely to have the chance of becoming a love mark. So I'm sorry the quality of the commercials wasn't what I would have liked, and we had to play them on the small screen, but I hope that that gave you a feel for love marks. Now I'm very happy to open a Q&A, and you should have on your screens a little speech bubble panel. If you open that and click your questions in, I will answer them verbally. And while you're thinking about it, just a couple of things I'd like to mention. For Edcom, the EACA runs a summer school, which is a week-long chance to work with some of the top practitioners in advertising. And this year we're running our summer school in Amsterdam. And this is for both graduates and undergraduates of universities across Europe. And details are on the Edcom website. And the other point to say is our next webinar will be on the 18th of April, when Nathan Miller is going to talk about gaming. And after that, on the 2nd of May, Dieter Dahmen will be talking to us as well. We hope we can get better quality commercials for the next ones, but I hope you've enjoyed this afternoon's webinar. And I'd be very happy to answer any questions that you want to type in. And thanks for your attention. And I hope you have a good day. Thank you. Right, let's just go through them. Fazana, thanks very much for your appreciation. I appreciate that. Celine, how do you think it's possible to find a balance between giving information to the customer and manipulating them? I think that going back to the point of mystery, what's really important is that I think you need to leave some things unsaid, some things uncommunicated. Some brands try to tell us everything about them, and I think that creates a problem. And I think it's absolutely important that we share enough information about a brand to get people interested, but then let them find out about the brand themselves. Let them discover the brand, because I think that's a much stronger way of doing it. Joanna, I was wondering whether you could choose one most important tip in creating a love mark, something which is definitely included in strategy towards creating a love mark. Absolutely, without hesitation, Joanna, I would say it's about consumer understanding. You absolutely need to understand what it is that consumers are doing and thinking when they buy a particular brand. Because only when you understand the consumer will you really be able to start creating the relationships and the communications that can start building towards a love mark. Farzana, what's the most important goal of the webinar? Other than a technical test for it, what we want to do for EdCom students is to have a monthly chance for you to hear different people working in the industry talking about a subject that they're passionate about. So it's, if you like, a taste rather than the complete understanding. And for example, the webinar I've given today, I will be expanding on that significantly at the summer school in Amsterdam. So really it's to give a taste, to give some new thoughts about how you might approach marketing and thinking about branding. So I hope that helps in that respect. Okay, well, I think I've answered the questions that come through. Ah, John, how do you measure a love mark? That's a very good question, John. And I think there is a long answer to this. But in short, what we did at Saatchi's is that we worked with a company called a research company called QualiQuant, who set up a love mark questionnaire, which was to really probe into the relationships consumers had with brands in a particular category, and not just how much did they trust them, how often did they buy them, etc., but really probing into the emotional connections that they had developed with that brand. And they were able to take this, and it was a quantitative piece of advertising backed up by some in-depth qual interviews. And from that, we were able to begin to plot brands on the love and respect axes. And it was very clear, particularly I remember looking at the area, for example, of software and hardware, Apple really did seem to bridge that gap and really had both the respect and the love of the consumers, which moved it towards a love mark, where other brands such as IBM, HP, and some of the other manufacturers, most of them were just worthy products. Farzana, you've asked, what do you do to reach students for the International Summer School? We advertise this amongst the EdCom universities. And for you to find out more, if you go to the EdCom website, which is where you should have picked up the link for this webinar, you'll find the Summer School agenda and the details there for registration. Celine, you've asked, which advertising did you prefer or keep in mind during the last month that showed creativity and a good understanding of customers? Again, in the UK, there's been a fantastic campaign for a yogurt called Yo Valley, which traditionally was rather a dull and worthy category. Yo Valley have produced an absolutely sensational campaign. You can probably find it on YouTube, where we actually have the farmers doing some rap music about the product. And it's turned what was a very boring regional yogurt brand into one of the sort of nation's favorite brands. So if you go onto YouTube and look at Yo Valley, I think you'll see what I mean. Great fun. Right, I think I'm going to have to end the session there. Thank you all very much for participating. Thanks for your questions, some great questions there. And as I said, have a good day, and I hope you can join us on the 18th of April when Nathan Miller is going to look into gaming, which should be an interesting area. So thank you all, and have a good afternoon. Goodbye now.